Take two. Today we're going to be taking a little look at the history of the radio. It all starts off in 1830 on the 13th of June when a little baby is born into the world named James Maxwell Clark at 14 Indian Street, Edinburgh. Just an old little baby at the time. By the age of 35, he had published a book named A Dynamic Theory of the Electromagnetic Field. He was the first person to think of combining both electricity and light into the same thing, kind of overlapping. It's quite a weird idea for the time. Some people had kind of thought about it, but hadn't really put it into practice. He didn't do any experiments at the time. It was all theoretical. I think 18 out of the 20 equations turned out to be correct. Not happened to the other two. Einstein cited him many times, saying that he was his predecessor. Many other famous people have used his work as the basis of their theories. Next year, a man named Malhoun Loomes started experimenting for real this time, using these theories and what they could be used for. His first experiment was, well, one of many experiments, was taking two kites and attaching a very long copper wire to them at the tops of two mountains. Two mountains were 2,000 feet apart, and the wire was 600 meters in length, which is, thankfully, today's radios, they don't have to be 600 meters in length to work. And at the time, it was just a on or off. It wasn't speech of any sort. It was all very basic, but it was the start. His documentation was quite terrible. Most of it was third-hand experience or just shoddy sketches. Right after that, a man named Heinrich Hertz, where the word Hertz gets its origin from, started doing these experiments in the lab. He was able to prove wavelengths existed by doing this weird, I don't even know how it properly worked, but two rods with balls of metal, and there was a little spark thing, and he was able to measure the arc of the spark and somehow managed to prove radio waves existed. After he'd finished his experiments, he was asked what was the importance of this, how could it be used? This is the quote from him. "It is of no use whatsoever. This is just an experiment that proves Maxwell was right. We have these mysterious electromagnetic waves that cannot be seen with the naked eye, but there they are." Little did he know, pretty big discovery he'd made. In 1889, he went to the Exposition Universelle in Paris, famously known for the Eiffel Tower, which is still here today. Wasn't meant to be permanent, but it was. Most visited attractions in the world that you have to pay to go see. There, someone came along, little person called Nikola Tesla. He would hear wind of these experiments that Hertz had been doing, give him a breath of fresh air into what direction he could go with the whole electricity thing that he'd been doing for the past 10, 20 years, something like that. There's a movie called Current Wars. Great movie. Goes on to his rivalries. If you got time, recommend watching it. One of his first public demonstrations was a boat. Looked a little bit like a submarine. He was able to remote control it around the bay to onlookers' amazement. They couldn't believe it. They thought it was telekinesis or he was magic. They didn't understand how it worked. But it did. It did work. He tried selling the idea off to the US Army or Navy. They didn't find it interesting. He tried selling the idea of remote-controlled torpedoes. They didn't seem all that interested.
Leaf.
From there, he started experimenting with wireless electricity. This is where most of his patents came from, around the radio, somehow thinking that he could use the ground or part of the atmosphere to conduct electricity wirelessly. Obviously it didn't work. It does to a certain degree, but very, very short distances, and it's highly inefficient. Didn't make any sense. Around the same time, a little bit after, an Italian man named Marconi, started experimenting with radios as well. His first written about experiment, he was able to send signals, only a couple kilometers at first, using the same method talked about earlier with the kites. This proved very successful. Over time, he was able to develop it so he could span thousands of kilometers. Yeah, from here, kind of just took off, really. It was, I guess, the birth of what you would call the modern radio. You could get signals where you couldn't get them before, like boats, remote islands, long, long distances, or just hard to reach places. Yeah, just places that wires couldn't get to by themselves. Okay, now let's talk about the technology behind it a little bit. Originally, there was no way of filtering out what you did and didn't want, so it was just a, or something along those fashion, just Morse code. The discovery of a particular type of crystal, or its properties per se, allowed you to filter out what was noise and what you needed to listen to. Only problem with this was there was no way of amplifying it, so you had to listen to it in very, very sensitive headphones. Sometimes it didn't work properly, it didn't pick up on particularly weak signals, so you had to be quite close to the source. But this changed with the invention of the vacuum tube. John Ambrose Fleming, and later developed by Lee DeForest, it allowed a very weak signal to come in, be amplified up many magnitudes greater, filter out any noise that you didn't want, and then play it to a room. These were hideously expensive though, compared to the previous crystal radios, costing a fourth of the price of a London home at the time, and was a little bit cheaper, but it was still insanely expensive. These radios were used in World War I, World War II for sending and receiving information. Not so much in World War I, they were used to communicate to aeroplanes and boats and people on the ground, but it still wasn't that reliable and required huge amounts of power to work properly. By World War II, massive. Just huge. Hitler kind of famously used it to spread propaganda around Germany. He destroyed pretty much all radios, and replaced them with his own that could only tune into his frequencies, so it was Hitler or nothing, I guess. I guess I'll play some recordings from around this time. They're quite famous. War of the Worlds.
From Grover's Mill by telephone. Just one moment, please. At least 40 people, including 6 state troopers, lie dead in a field east of the village of Grover's Mill, their bodies burned and distorted beyond all possible recognition. The next voice you hear will be that of Brigadier General Montgomery Smith, commander of the state militia at Trenton, New Jersey.
I have been requested by the governor of New Jersey to place the counties of Mercer and Middlesex as far west as Princeton and east to Jamesburg under martial law. No one will be permitted.
This was a broadcast that was sent when it was still relatively new technology. There were heaps of news reports of people thinking that the world had ended, people going out into the streets, just losing their shite. Other famous recordings, the Queen, her speech to the nation during World War II.
We children at home are full of cheerfulness and courage. We are trying to do all we can to help our gallant sailors, soldiers, and airmen. And we are trying, too, to bear our own share of the danger and sadness of war. We know, every one of us, that in the end all will be well. For God will care for us and give us victory and peace.
Winston Churchill. He also made a famous speech to the public.
We shall fight in France. We shall fight on the seas and oceans. We shall fight with growing confidence and growing strength in the air. We shall defend our island, whatever the cost may be. We shall fight on the beaches. We shall fight on the landing grounds. We shall fight in the fields and in the streets. We shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender.
In the next video, I'll be taking a look at more of the products themselves.